Thanks very much, Becky. Hi everyone, welcome to today's webinar. So Becky's always given us the title, and I'll just mention my co-author, Yanhui Zhang, who works with me in the Fatigue Integrity Management section at TWI. So this presentation was originally given at the Structural Integrity Conference in November last year, and so we're going to be talking about fatigue design considerations for offshore wind and how that relates to oil and gas structures. But before we get started, I'll just say a few words about TWI for those of you who may not know. So TWI, which you might know as the Welding Institute, is a research and technology organization, and our core strengths relate to materials and joining technology. So as well as carrying out consultancy for individual clients, we also do research and development through internal projects as well as through innovation centers. We have a training school where you can gain qualifications on topics including welding engineering and weld inspection. And the pictures on the screen here show some examples of the types of technologies that we work on, which range from mechanical testing to all different types of welding, additive manufacturing and inspection techniques. And we do all of this work for our industrial members. Our TWI's headquarters are in Cambridge in the UK, and we have several other offices around the world. So in the UK, our sites have different areas of expertise. We have experts in laser additive manufacturing and friction stir welding up in Rotherham. We have state-of-the-art NDT specialists in Port Talbot. In Aberdeen, we have a training centre, and in Middlesbrough, we have our numerical modelling colleagues and underwater welding training centre in Middlesbrough. So let's get to the content of today's presentation. So the aim of today's presentation is to go through the background of the commonly used fatigue design documents, to identify and highlight the differences in fatigue conditions between those which are experienced by oil and gas structures and those which are experienced by offshore wind substructures, and then highlight research gaps in fatigue design for offshore wind substructures. Because ultimately, with research, we could avoid overly conservative assumptions, which could ultimately reduce manufacturing costs whilst ensuring safe operation. So in this presentation, I'll start by providing some numbers to illustrate the increase in deployment of offshore wind installations. And then I'll go through the origins of the existing design guidance and the relationship to oil and gas. I'll highlight some of the aspects of offshore wind substructures that are relevant to fatigue design, namely high cycle fatigue, corrosion fatigue, the thickness correction factor, hotspot stress analysis, the design fatigue factor, and fracture mechanics MK factor, as well as the fatigue crack growth rate laws. And then I'll finish with some key takeaways in the conclusions part. So just to set the scene, and starting with the increase in deployment of wind farms, this plot here shows the annual increase in installed capacity of wind farms around the world. As you can see, 2019 was a record year for installed wind farm capacity, in which 6,000 megawatts was installed worldwide. And 2020 almost matched that amount of installed capacity. A few years ago, Germany was installing the most capacity, and in recent years, the largest capacity increases have been in the UK and China. So considering all of the installed capacity, there was 32 gigawatts installed globally as of 2020. And this plot just shows how rapidly the rate of increase of installation is increasing. So even with the current rapid growth of the industry, governments worldwide have pledged to generate even larger amounts of energy from wind. So this plot shows that by 2031, China has estimated to have almost 40 gigawatts of total installed capacity. And that, so in just 10 years' time, China's installed wind capacity may exceed the amount of wind capacity currently installed worldwide. So the challenge of meeting these targets is just immense. Obviously, wind turbines themselves, the actual generator, need to be installed at height so that they can access the highest wind speeds and so that there's clearance for the turbine blades. And so the wind turbine itself is mounted on a tower. The tower is usually essentially a large steel tube which is mounted on a foundation. And this plot here looks at the different types of foundations in use and shows that 24 gigawatts of the currently installed 32 gigawatts use monopile foundations. And monopiles are again large steel tubes which are driven into the seabed. The second most popular type of foundation is a jacket structure. And in the future, as shallow offshore sites become filled, in order to meet the pledged capacities of offshore wind, floating foundations will need to be used. All of these structures are very large, fabricated steel structures which contain welded joints. And the combination of cyclic loads from the actions of the ocean, as well as the additional aerodynamic loads from the action of the wind turbine, mean that these structures must obviously be designed for fatigue. And it's the fatigue life of welds which control the operational lifetime of these structures. So this brings me on to the fatigue design documents, which provide guidance on fatigue design for offshore wind substructures. There are several different DNV design documents which cover support structures in general, as well as floating structures. And those documents refer to the fatigue design guidance in DNV RP C203 for both the SN curves and the analysis methods. The ABS document for offshore wind structures refers to the ABS guide for fatigue assessment of offshore structures. The China Classification Society document for offshore structures is based on the UK's Health and Safety Executive HSE guidance notes, which uses SN curves from that document, and those are the same as those in British Standard BS 7608. So just to summarise at a high level, and obviously given that the fatigue design guidance for offshore wind substructures refer back to other documents, and I'll explain the origins of the guidance in those documents. But before I do that, I'll just highlight the fact that in general, fatigue cracking tends to occur at stress concentrations in structures, and welds are particularly susceptible to fatigue cracking, with cracks typically occurring at weld toes. And that's due to the presence of high tensile residual stresses, stress concentrations due to changes in cross-section, as well as the presence of small crack-like flaws at the toes of arc welds. Bolts are also critical to integrity of structures, and depending on the applied loading direction, cracks can occur either in the plates that are clamped by the bolts or under the loading conditions experienced by flange connections at the threads in the bolts. But the fatigue performance of all welds on a primary structure with a subject to cyclic loads should be considered. So that includes seemingly innocuous welded attachments, which can also crack by fatigue. And for example, the picture on the top right of the screen there shows an example of a welded attachment where a fatigue crack is propagated all the way through the main plate. So the point I'm trying to make here is that welded joints are critical for fatigue performance and are often the places where fatigue cracks will occur. So back to the main thrust of the presentation. So now if we go on to the origin of the SN curves and fatigue design documents. So the approach of grouping welded joints into fatigue classes was developed by TWI in the 1970s by analysing sets of test data gathered at that time. The design curves for steels in seawater are mostly based on data from UK Offshore Research Project, which ran in the 1980s. That programme involved testing tubular steel jacket structures to generate fatigue design data for offshore oil and gas structures. And the test conditions represented operating conditions in the North Sea. So that used simulated seawater at temperatures of between 6 and 10 degrees C, and a cycling frequency of 0.17 hertz, 1/6 of a hertz. The results from that programme were combined with data from other projects, and fatigue design guidance for offshore oil and gas structures was published by the Department of Energy. And those documents are referred to as the HSE Offshore Guidance Notes. That guidance was then adopted or adapted by other standards bodies. Although these HSE guidance notes have now been withdrawn, much of the content of those notes was actually retained in British Standard BS 7608, as well as in the ISO 19902 document. So there are therefore several fatigue design documents currently used by the oil and gas sector, and those are listed on the slide here. So DNV RPC 203 focuses entirely on offshore structures. BS 7608 is the British standard version, which is an assessment procedure for welded joints in any application, not only offshore. The rules in BS 7608 are similar to those originally published in the HSE guidance notes, and the seawater SN curves are based on the data from that UK offshore research programme that I mentioned before. ISO 19902 is for fixed steel offshore structures. ABS has a document for fatigue assessment of offshore structures, and the Chinese guideline for fatigue design is based on the UK HSE guidance notes again. There are some differences between oil and gas structures and offshore wind substructures in terms of fatigue. So firstly, offshore wind structures experience a high number of cycles at very low stress ranges, and so damage from small stresses is very important to their fatigue performance. As we know, loading frequency affects corrosion fatigue performance. The oil and gas structures are mainly subjected to wave loading, which in the North Sea occurs at a frequency of 0.17 hertz, whereas in offshore wind structures, as well as wave loading, there are also cyclic loads associated with the turbine itself, leading to different relevant loading frequencies. Large thicknesses are used in wind monopiles and towers in order to reduce the magnitude of fatigue stresses. The wall thicknesses are upwards of 40 millimetres and often as large as 150 millimetres. And there's a thickness effect on fatigue performance. So a thickness penalty is recommended in fatigue design standards when plate thicknesses are larger than the thickness of plates used to derive the SN curves. And the reference thickness is usually 25 millimetres. So the other consequence of large thicknesses is that the welding induced residual stresses may be high, and high residual stresses affect fatigue performance. Coupled with that, no post-weld heat treatment is carried out on monopile welds, whereas in other industries, the design documents recommend that post-weld heat treatment is carried out to reduce residual stresses in thick sections. And oil and gas data is derived from testing standard arc welds, whereas welds in wind structures are mainly fabricated by submerged arc welding. And in early editions of the fatigue design standards, submerged arc welds were assigned to a lower fatigue class than other types of arc welds. However, recent reanalysis of more modern data found that the performance of submerged arc welds was actually in line with that of other types of arc welds. So going through some of these points in a bit more detail, I mentioned that the fatigue damage in offshore wind structures occurs mainly at low stress ranges and very high number of cycles. If the fatigue damage occurs at a stress range which is very close to the constant amplitude fatigue limit, then the position of the constant amplitude fatigue limit, which is also known as the slope transition point, is very important for the fatigue design of the offshore wind structure. So on the plot here, the point at which the slope changes affects the fatigue life that will be predicted using these SN curves. This change in slope in the design curves was originally proposed by Heibeck in 1971. It's the point at which the slope changes from a slope of m to m plus 2, and this accounts for the smaller influence on fatigue crack propagation of small stress cycles in the high cycle regime when under variable amplitude loading. And it was included in the various design standards and originally placed at 10 to the 7 cycles. So this point shown here. In the HSE guidance notes, and the approach also adopted by DNV RPC 203, in air, the slope changes from 3 to 5 at 10 to the 7 cycles. In seawater with CP, the SN curves are reduced by a factor of 2.5 on life, above 10 to the 6 cycles, and then they match the air curves above 10 to the 7, whereas under free corrosion in seawater, the life's reduced by a factor of 3 compared to air performance with no change in slope. There's a difference in BSM 608 when we're considering variable amplitude loading. So in seawater with cathodic protection and under free corrosion, the curves are the same as in the HSE document I've just described. But in air, in the most recent update of BSM 608, the change in slope has been placed at from 3 to 5 at 5 × 10⁷ cycles. So it's been placed at a higher endurance for the in-air variable amplitude fatigue performance. And the point to note here really is that the SN curves in the long life regime are based on deductive reasoning or engineering judgment from a limited number of test results. And even fewer results are available in marine environments, because when you're testing in a corrosive environment, the test frequencies must be very low, and so the test durations would be unfeasibly long. And so since the choice of the slope transition point is based on not many test results, the different standard bodies have diverged in their interpretation of those results. And the position of the slope transition point does have an influence on the predicted fatigue life, the stress spectra with a variable amplitude. So that's one important consideration. The single slope free corrosion curve is based on the argument that a crack could develop from a corrosion pit to any applied stress range due to the stress concentrating effect of the pit. But there's still a question over whether a slope of 3 at low stress ranges is suitable, given that cracking could still occur at a weld toe rather than from a corrosion pit. And offshore wind structures are subject to corrosion, and we know this from structures that are installed in service, and there are reports of quite high level of corrosion even in structures which have been protected with corrosion resistant coatings. So as I mentioned earlier, the logic behind having a single slope in the under free corrosion conditions is that the fatigue cracks can initiate from corrosion pits at any applied stress range. These images here show examples of fatigue cracks which have initiated from corrosion pits in mooring chains, which were fatigue tested in free corrosion conditions in seawater. And you can see fatigue cracks initiating from a corrosion pit in the top left image there. However, we've done some other work at TWI where we have looked at the fatigue performance of a decommissioned structure. So we ran a joint industry project where a decommissioned jacket structure, which had been in service for 40 years, was investigated further. There was extensive corrosion on the parts. The welds were subjected to detailed inspection, and no indications of fatigue cracking were identified in any of the critical locations or from any of the corroded areas. And then we subjected these joints to further fatigue testing to determine what their fatigue performance would be. What we found is that the specimen's performance was in line with the fatigue design curves, and so there was no clear degradation in fatigue performance of the aged structure. And so the current design approach for oil and gas structures might actually be over-conservative. Okay, so moving on to the next topic, which is the thickness correction. The design documents include a penalty on fatigue life for thicker structures via the thickness correction factor. In its basic form, it's the ratio of the thickness of the main plate compared to a reference thickness, all to the power 0.25. That reference thickness is typically 25 millimetres. And just to illustrate that with an example, with the basic thickness correction factor, the fatigue life of a weld in 120 millimeter thick plate would be reduced by a factor of 3.2 using this thickness correction factor at the top here. In DMV RPC 203 and also in the IIW fatigue design guidance documents, they use a modified form of the thickness correction factor, which takes account of the width of the weld in the way that the effective thickness is calculated. And that approach is based solely on the fracture mechanics crack growth calculations rather than test data. Using this method, if you were to calculate the thickness penalty for a submerged arc weld that had a width of 50 millimetres, the fatigue life would only be reduced by a factor of 1.4. So it does result in a smaller fitness correction penalty. But there is some data which raises questions on the effect of thickness on fatigue performance and highlights the importance of looking at fatigue test data rather than just using analytical methods. So this plot here shows results from full-scale fatigue tests on pipes with wall thicknesses ranging from 15 to 25 millimetres. The mean curves plotted for each set of wall thicknesses show that the data set from pipes with larger thicknesses actually had the highest fatigue performance, meaning that the fatigue strength could actually increase with increase in wall thickness. And that might be due to favourable compressive residual stresses at the weld root. So the reason I show these results is that they demonstrate that there are many factors that affect the fatigue performance of welded joints. It's not only the actual thickness, which controls the stress gradient, but also aspects such as residual stresses and other things related to the fabrication. So I'll briefly mention hotspot stress analysis now. So in this method, the geometric stress is extrapolated to the weld toe. And this hotspot stress is used along with the T or the TJ SN curves from the design codes in the fatigue analysis. This method is most commonly used for the fatigue analysis of tubular nodal joints, and so it would be suitable for analysing welds in jacket offshore wind foundations. Existing guidance is suitable for both oil and gas structures and offshore wind structures, although it should be noted that the T and the TJ SN curves were obtained from analysis of fatigue performance of double-sided nodal joints, whereas in wind structures, they tend to be welded from one side. The concern with the fatigue performance of offshore wind jacket structures is more likely to be a fabrication quality issue, given that rather than one-off structures produced in oil and gas, lots of foundations are required for a wind farm. And so, and there's a push in the wind industry towards rapid serial production. So the quality of any welds fabricated needs to be taken into account and understood. Moving on to design fatigue factors. There are several different safety factors which are applied to the required life, meaning that the allowable stresses are reduced in order to achieve the factored life. In oil and gas structures, where the structures are manned or failure could result in release of harmful chemicals, the consequence of failure is very high. And the oil and gas standards therefore include a safety factor of up to 10. As I mentioned earlier, the investigation of the decommissioned structure showed no decrease in fatigue performance of the joints after 40 years in service. And so these safety factors might be higher than necessary for those structures. The consequence of failure for an offshore wind structure is less severe since the structures are not manned and failure would not result in the release of anything into the environment. And so offshore wind design guidance documents include a maximum design factor, design fatigue factor of 3. So several of the areas that I've already mentioned require some additional research, and I'll just highlight a couple of other areas as well. One is the MK factor for the fracture mechanics analysis of fatigue crack growth in girth welds, and the other is the fatigue crack growth laws themselves. So as we know, fatigue cracking often occurs at the toe of welded joints. And in engineering critical assessment, the high stress concentration at a weld toe is accounted for using the stress intensity magnification factor, which is given the symbol MK. And this accounts for the presence of a weld of the weld bead. BS7910 provides MK solutions for fatigue crack growth assessments. In BS7910, there are two MK factor solutions provided. The 2D MK factor was derived for a butt weld, but as you can see in the image there, the geometry considered was more similar to that of a fillet weld in terms of its dimensions. The 3D MK factor was derived considering the geometry of a fillet welded attachment, or a T joint, as shown in the lower image there. And it's more accurate and less conservative than the 2D solution, but it does actually apply to fillet welds rather than butt welds. As we know from looking at the design SN curves, but welds are typically a class D or E detail, whereas fillet welds have a lower fatigue performance and are usually class F. With the current MK factor solutions, this fundamental difference in fatigue performance of butt welds compared to fillet welds is not actually taken into account, and instead the lower performance of a fillet weld is calculated. It's also been shown that the fatigue performance of a butt weld is affected by the weld profile, and the graph on the top right shows that a smaller weld toe angle results in a better fatigue performance. The submerged arc welds used in offshore wind structures tend to have quite a small weld angle, like the example shown in the lower image. And so the MK solutions in BS7910 don't really represent the geometries of typical butt welds in offshore wind structures very well. And so new MK factors are needed to account for these different geometries. And they would improve the accuracy of the predicted fatigue life when using fracture mechanics. And TWI is actually launching a JRP to investigate this area and develop new solutions. As well as the MK factors and many other things, BS7910 also provides fatigue crack growth laws for steels. The mean and the design values are provided. And again, all of these were derived from analysis of sets of test data. The data used to derive the fatigue crack growth laws provided in BS7910 was obtained more than 20 years ago, and a limited amount of it is from steels used in offshore wind structures. And so finally, the applicability of the current fatigue crack growth laws to offshore wind structures needs to be examined and double checked. And one aspect in particular is the position of the threshold delta K values. The position of that threshold delta K depends on the stress ratio experienced by the fatigue crack. And the large residual stresses in welds in offshore wind structures is likely to result in a high stress ratio, perhaps greater than 0.7, which would affect the near threshold fatigue crack propagation rates. And so again, that's an area that needs to be examined and double checked for offshore wind. And this brings me close to the end of the presentation. The final point I'd like to make is that the fatigue performance of welds depends on lots of factors relating to fabrication as well as geometry. So as well as the actual geometry of the joint and the orientation of applied stresses with respect to the weld, it also depends on how the weld has been fabricated. So in order to have confidence in the actual fatigue performance of a fabricated welded joint, it's a good idea to carry out tests on representative welds. Those test results might show that the weld actually has a higher fatigue performance than expected by the standard design SN curve, and that would enable the designer to justify a longer lifetime of the structure. But if the fatigue performance is shown to be shorter, by understanding the failure of a welded joint, you can adjust and modify welding procedures to improve fatigue performance of the actual component before you go and deploy it offshore. So that brings me to the end of my presentation. So just to summarise some of the points that I've made here. So the current fatigue design standards are based on data which was generated over several decades. The first point is that the recommendations are sound and appropriate for the conditions considered, but many of the updates to those fatigue design rules do relate to developments in the oil and gas industry. And there are some differences in the operation of offshore wind structures compared to oil and gas structures, which will affect the fatigue design calculations, and in particular may make fatigue design more conservative than it needs to be. So the position of the slope transition point is important, given that the majority of stress ranges experienced by offshore wind structures are close to the constant amplitude fatigue limit, and therefore the slope transition point. And the location of that slope transition point will affect the calculated fatigue life. The next is the thickness correction factor for thick welded steels. This should be investigated to confirm whether it's appropriate for thicknesses relevant to offshore wind structures, because the current thickness correction approach might be over conservative. Offshore wind structures are expected to have high levels of residual stress due to the large thickness and the lack of post-weld heat treatment, and that might affect the threshold stress intensity factor in fatigue crack growth rate calculations. If the threshold delta K is lower than currently recommended. That means that cracks may be able to propagate at lower values of delta K. The current MK factors used in fracture mechanics assessments were derived for fillet welded geometries and are too conservative for the shallow weld profiles of offshore wind structures and the submerged arc welds used in those structures. Validation of the fatigue crack growth rate laws in BS7910 is needed for the steels used in offshore wind structures. And finally, fatigue testing on welded joints is useful to provide valuable insights into their fatigue performance and would give designers more confidence in the actual fatigue life of a particular welded joint in a structure. So given the worldwide government commitments to the use of even more offshore wind, coordinated industry research is needed to address these issues, as updates to design guidance could reduce the over-conservatism in design, allowing costs to be reduced whilst ensuring the integrity of offshore wind structures is maintained. So that brings me all the way to the end. So thank you very much for listening. If you do have any questions, I see a few of them are popping up in the Q&A box, so I'll go through some of them now. Otherwise, you can contact us using the email address on the screen there, and do have a look at the TWI website as well.
Thanks, Carol. Do you want me to read them out? Okay. Is there a typical load spectrum for turbine blades? How to model stress ranges from a rotating turbine blade?
Good question. So, the focus of my presentation today has been entirely on the substructures, and I don't know about a typical loading spectrum, but what I do know is that it's important to do a time-based fatigue analysis rather than you need to do the fatigue analysis in the time domain to make sure that you are properly coupling the fatigue cycles from the rotation of the turbine with those from the ocean environment. You need to do that in the time domain, but I'm not sure whether this is a typical one.
Okay. About the design of bolts on bolted flange connections on offshore wind foundations, these normally use hot dip galvanized bolts and use S-N curve G according to DMV-RP-C203. Are we being over-conservative assuming a DFF of 3 for this detail, given that the failure of one bolt will not be of high consequence?
So in terms of the fatigue performance of bolts on flange connections, so we have done some work at TWI testing hot dip galvanized bolts with a large diameter, and our results on M72 bolts confirm that the DMV class G curve is the right one to apply to these large diameter galvanized bolts. In terms of the relevant design fatigue factor of 3, I take your point that the failure of one bolt will not be of high consequence, but the problem with a single bolt failing is that does overload and put higher loads on the adjacent bolts. So as soon as you have the failure of one bolt, then that is going to initiate and make it more likely for the other bolts within the flange to fail. So it's a good question as to whether that needs to be adjusted. But the other point is that a design fatigue factor of 3 is also quite small, actually. As I noted there, in oil and gas, they use factors of 10. I think it sounds reasonable to me, basically.
Thank you. How CTOD requirements of welds, coarse-grained HAZ and fine-grained HAZ, has changed when it comes to OWS?
Yeah, so are there any different CTOD requirements for the different heat affected zones in offshore wind structures? Good question, and I'm not sure. I think some of my colleagues in the metallurgy department might be able to help you with that, but I don't know.
Okay, I'll leave that one live and get back to them. The next one is, greetings, Carol. Thank you for your intriguing presentation. First question is, based on your comment that S-N curves are determined based on a low data set and scientific reasoning, Do you think we are designing the structures with a high level of conservative approach and therefore leading to over-engineered structures, higher cost, etc.? I'm interested in looking at microstructure at and near weld zone before and after failure. It would allow us to understand in more detail the crack growth, propagation, and if changing weld materials could result in slower crack growth. Just a thought, really enjoyed your presentation.
Yeah, thanks. I think the other point to make about fatigue design is that it is important that the fatigue design documents do include a level of conservatism, because there is so much scatter in the fatigue performance of welded joints due to aspects which are really difficult to quantify relating to fabrication. So even if you qualify a welder and a welder procedure using standard tests like bend test, tensile test, and all those other mechanical tests, that doesn't give you any indication about what the fatigue performance of that weld is. So intrinsically, these fatigue design documents do need to be include a level of conservatism to make sure that they provide lower bound levels of fatigue performance of welded joints. But I do think that there are areas where these curves can be improved in order to reduce that level of conservatism, so that they're still conservative, but not too conservative. So an example I'd give of that is the analysis of the T-crack growth rate data provided in VS7910. So I didn't mention it in this presentation, but they do provide two different fatigue crack growth rate curves. One of them is a simple curve with a single slope, and that obviously is quite a conservative approach, particularly at low delta K, which is why when you look at the fatigue performance if you look at the actual data, you find that this two slope curve is actually more appropriate, which is why so it's still conservative, but it's slightly less so. So I think that there's some work that can be done in their high cycle regime to reduce conservatism, but make sure that we still have some conservatism there. Your research sounds interesting as well, looking at different welding consumables and fatigue crack growth rate.
Great. Due to the large size of the tubeless shaft supporting the turbine, is it better to use an FE shell model versus a 2D tubular?
I don't know. Not sure. I'm afraid. I don't know the answer.
Okay. Shall we leave that one open and maybe somebody else can get back to them? Okay. Is there any formula to convert Sharpie impact test value into CTOD value?
That's not kind of relevant to the fatigue presentation that I've given today, but I would direct you towards VS7910 for some conversion equations.
Okay. In floating wind, the critical area seems to be at the connection between turbine tower and substructure. The stress at the connection could be a higher stress level. Any information to be shared for the area?
Yeah, so I would say that applies to all types of offshore wind. So the connection, the highest bending stresses are going to be at the point between the tower and the foundation. That applies to fixed as well as floating structures. The issue that I see with floating wind is that there's so many different designs of floating wind foundations, meaning that there are so many different types. There are, you know, these barge types, there's tripods, there's concrete type spar structures, there's all different types of wind turbine substructures and floating wind substructure designs that it's hard to make any general comments about or provide any data about floating wind in general. But I would say that fatigue analysis becomes a lot more complicated for floating wind structures, because obviously the whole foundation is moving as well as the hydrodynamic and ocean effects. So you've got, and the aerodynamic effects, I mean. So everything gets even more complicated with floating wind. So my recommendation and suggestion would be to do some fatigue testing. If you have any concerns over any of the welded joints that are being used in floating wind substructures or any other structures, it's a really good idea to do fatigue testing to make sure that you fully understand their fatigue performance.
Okay. About the non, I think it's Gaussian nature of the stress signals. Do wind turbine structures come with stronger non-Gaussianity compared to oil and gas assets? How does that affect the fatigue performance? Apologies for the pronunciation.
So I'm not quite sure that I understand the question there. I don't know. I might have to get back to you on that one.
Okay. Is there a potential benefit of performing tests to justify the use of better SN curve?
Yeah, definitely. This is very commonly done in the oil and gas industry. So I spend a lot of my time performing full-scale fatigue tests on wells in pipelines. And quite often we can use those test results to justify the use of a higher SN curve, because what you find in industries where they have developed and honed the fatigue performance of their welding procedures, that actually the fatigue performance can be quite well controlled, resulting in a high fatigue strength. So if you do a series of fatigue tests, then you can use those results to justify the use of a higher SN curve in your design, and therefore justify a longer fatigue life for your component. So yeah, there's definitely a benefit of doing fatigue tests.
For the different contributions to fatigue for offshore wind substructure, is there needed to be looked into any correlation, i.e. overlapping of stress cycles for the fatigue damage calculations, or is this covered by a present fatigue stress cycle calculation by time domain analysis?
So my understanding and recommendation is that if you carry out the analysis in the time domain, then that takes account of both the aerodynamic stresses and those stresses due to the ocean environment. So as opposed to working in the frequency domain where you cancel out and miss out the both aspects of the fatigue loading. So you need to carry out the analysis in the time domain.
Great. Great presentation, Carol. One question: we can use some superficial treatment to improve the fatigue resistance of a weld join, like shut peening treatment.
So that's a good point. I didn't mention fatigue improvement methods, but it is possible to use different methods to try and improve the fatigue performance of a welded joint. The one thing that I would say is that you shouldn't rely on fatigue improvement methods to enhance fatigue performance at the design stage. If your fatigue analysis shows that your welded joint won't have enough, if your fatigue analysis shows that your welded joint won't have enough fatigue life, then it's better to go back to the drawing board and try using a different class of welded joint, or to try and place your welds in a lower stress area. I would say it's not really the best practice to try and rely on fatigue improvement methods from the design stage. Where they are useful is if you do find that in service and in operation, you're getting fatigue cracks on welded joints that you didn't expect. You can then use grinding or peening or something like that to try and improve the fatigue performance of other similar welds in your structures.
Great, thank you for that. Just a couple more. Have you got time? Just as a couple more?
I think that's probably quite a lot, I think.
Okay, that's fine.
So there's one more that's come in that I will answer. How can a test be performed for low stresses where the numbers of cycles are above 10 to the 6 or 10 to the 7? So there are fatigue testing techniques which apply to in-air testing, which can run at quite at relatively high frequencies. So one method is resonance fatigue testing, which we use regularly on full-scale pipes, and that runs at 30 hertz. So you can accumulate 1 million cycles in a day and 10 million cycles in a week. So it's possible to run to quite high numbers of cycles using high-frequency test techniques like resonance testing.
Right, thanks. Okay, I think that's it. So we'll get back to the people that we with the answers from the ones that you weren't sure about, if that's okay. Okay, that's great. Well, thank you very much. Thank you, everybody, for attending. And we will be sending out a copy of the recording and the presentation in the next couple of days. So thank you. And thank you, Carol, for a lovely presentation.
Thanks, everyone. Bye-bye.